Today, we'll talk a little bit about what I think is a milestone in 3D HD medical visualization. That is, there we go. First, disclosures. I have absolutely no financial interest in the subject matter being presented here today. I do have some relationships with two companies that have nothing to do with what we're talking about. And some of the things I'll mention today are not FDA approved. So I'd like to acknowledge the folks at TruVision, Optronics, and Leica for being very generous with their equipment and helping us set this up and make all of this possible. And of course, the Program Selection Committee for the privilege of speaking with you today. We're going to talk about an important milestone in medical 3D HD machine vision in the field of microsurgery. Okay? Specifically, a tiny little sliver of microsurgery, which is epiretinal membrane peeling, which is a subsegment of vitreoretinal surgery, which is a subsegment of ophthalmic surgery. And we'll talk about what this means in terms of the validity of actually thinking about applying 3D HD machine vision to medical, diagnostic, and surgical procedures for surgery as a whole, for ophthalmic surgery specifically, and then a little bit about vitreoretinal surgery in the future. So microsurgery has been around since the 1960s. We started off using loops to give us, you know, 2 to 6x magnification to help us see things a little bit better. This very rapidly progressed to using a very sophisticated surgical microscopes that give us very clear visual stereoscopic visualization of surgical fields. This is used in neurosurgery, vascular surgery, a whole host of medical subspecialties, and most importantly, because you see this is what I do for a living, ophthalmology. Here is a view of a cataract being extracted. Ophthalmic surgery is actually a fairly diverse field, ophthalmic surgery is. Here's the lens being placed, the intraocular lens implant being placed into the eye of the previous cataract surgery patient. Here's an eye undergoing glaucoma surgery. All of these are done under the operating microscope. This is a fresh corneal transplant. And of course, the most important part of ophthalmic surgery, because it's what I do, vitreoretinal surgeon, this is a retinal detachment, and here's instruments inside the eye. This is the optic nerve, a retinal detachment being fixed. So just a little refresher of high school biology. The eye is a spheroid-type environment that's a little bit shy of an inch in all dimensions. Light enters the front of the eye. It's focused by the cornea, the pupil, and the lens, and impacts the retina, which is where the magic of vision happens. The retina, this is an en face view of the retina. You see the fovea centralis right there. You see the optic nerve here. The entire macular region is right over here. And if we take a cross-section of that, we can see that the retina is a tissue. The retinal blood vessels actually sit on top of the retina. The photoreceptors are at the deepest end of the retina. And if we magnify this further, we need light microscopy. You can see that the retina has all of these specialized cellular layers, and it ranges, depending on where you are in the eye, between 80 and 320 microns in thickness. Here's a graphic representation of all of these layers and their fancy names. Turns out that in the clinic, non-destructively, we can use something called optical coherence tomography, which is a time-of-flight optical laser B-scan, to image the retina. This is a normal retina and a slice through the fovea centralis, and you can actually see these striations of all of these layers. You can see these in these OCT scans. This is an OCT scan of a patient that I will show you the surgery of, where you can see that there's a problem. The visual acuity is reduced to about 2050, and you see this scar tissue built up on the surface of the retina that's wrinkling up the retina. You see some cystic degeneration here that's distorting the normal microscopic architecture of the retina. So how do we repair these things, and how do we surgically do membrane removal? Well, it's based on entering the back of the eye. We place trocars into the eye. This video is courtesy of Alcon. This is a freeze frame of what it actually looks like at the beginning of a retinal surgery. We put usually three, sometimes two, sometimes four trocars into the eye to gain surgical access to the posterior segment of the eye. The interesting factoid here is that these instruments nowadays are 500 microns in diameter. So the internal lumen of these trocars is 500 microns. So here's an intraocular view. If we could maybe kill the lights a little bit, that would be good. Thank you. Here's the instrument. This forceps that's grabbing this little membrane is 500 microns in diameter. This blood vessel that you see right here is approximately 150 microns in diameter. And in case you didn't believe me that the retina is precisely 100, 200, 300 microns in thickness, in this picture, the light is coming in from the top. And if you look at this retinal blood vessel, you can clearly see that you see the red blood vessel and the black shadow underneath it. And the distance between the two is certainly congruous with the notion that the thickness of that membrane, of that tissue, is approximately 100, 200 microns in order of magnitude, and that the retina is indeed clear. So here you see this forceps is grabbing this membrane and pulling, and the scar tissue that you see on the surface of the retina and underlying layers under the scar tissue, which are called the retina internal limiting membrane, they are 1 to 4 microns in thickness usually. So what this means is that this is from a micromanipulation standpoint, really some of the most micromanipulative surgery there is in all of medicine. So obviously we need an operating room microscope to do that kind of work. That mags up between 5 and 40-fold. In addition to neutralize the natural focusing of the cornea and the lens, we use all sorts of auxiliary lenses that we stick in front of or on top of the eye. And what that means is we get glare off the operating room microscope. So the first thing that the retinal surgeon does, as opposed to pretty much any other surgeon in medicine, is we turn the microscope light off, right? And we replace it with an intraocular fiber optic light source that you see here in my right hand. I have a vitreous cutter in my left hand that has an internal diameter of about 400 microns. So that big, beautiful microscope light that the really bright engineers at the microscope manufacturing companies have engineered gets turned off. I'll skip that. So shortly after we started doing microsurgery, some bright person started hooking video cameras to the microscope. Well, we all know that 20/20 visual acuity, which is somewhat arbitrarily defined as normal, corresponds to approximately 1 arc minute of angular resolution. If you do a little bit of math and you set up a video viewing system to mimic the field of view and the geometry of what I see when I look through an operating room microscope, you have we arrive with these you can derive these equivalent visual acuities of standard definition video. 480i is about 2100 for stationary objects, and as soon as you introduce interlace artifact by moving something, the visual acuity gets cut in half, 2200 visual acuity. With high definition video, especially in the horizontal direction, you have a visual acuity approximately of about 2040, which is certainly much better. To demonstrate that, these are video frame grabs. Here's a 1080p ophthalmic video, a 480i ophthalmic video, and these really look the same because they're scrunched down to fit on this PowerPoint slide. But if you look at the fact that you see the reflection of the operating room lights here, in the ceiling of the operating room, and here, the same operating room, same microscope, and you then crop a digitally zoom, you can really see the enhanced detail both in the operating room light reflection here versus here, as well as the conjunctival blood vessels right here at the limbus, which is where the white part of the eye meets the colored part of the eye, here verses here. If you look real carefully and turn on your imagination genes, right at the tip of this little black arrow, it's not projecting that well, I don't think, you see a little white smudge. That is an individual leukocyte that is in this blood vessel. This hexagonal pattern, these are all video frame grabs. Right? That's important. These are not still pictures. These are video frame grabs. This hexagonal pattern on the back of a cornea, those hexagons correspond to individual corneal endothelial cells. So we've got great visual acuity with high-definition video in the eye, and well, if it turns out that there's a well-established relationship between two-dimensional visual acuity and three-dimensional stereo acuity. Standard definition video corresponds to terrible, only gross stereo vision. High-definition video corresponds to fairly high-grade stereo acuity. So that asks, that brings up a question. Can we do this very technically challenging vitreoretinal surgery, including membrane peeling, using 3D HD machine vision for primary visualization? Turns out that we had not one but two different systems of 3D HD machine vision. The TrueVision folks brought in their unit very kindly. Here I am wearing these unbelievably sexy TrueVision goggles. I do not have oculars in front of me. I have a patient on the table. I have my hands on instruments which are in the eye of the patient, and I am looking at the image. Here's the other view on the TrueVision screen. The TrueVision system consists of two 5-megapixel CMOS sensors, a quad-core CPU, a row-interleaved polarized display with passive glasses, and of course we use the hook it to the surgical microscope. Because we have six operating rooms at the Cincinnati Eye Institute and only one TrueVision surgeon, TrueVision system, and our administrators were sick and tired of the fist fights in the hallway between the surgeons for who was going to get the TrueVision system that day, we went ahead and kind of cobbled together, or I went ahead and cobbled together another 3D visualization system, which was comprised of two Optronics Microcrest HD cameras. These are cost-effective, high-quality cameras, which we connected to the microscope using a beam splitter and C-mount adapters. I actually brought in my two BenQ W5000 DLP projectors from home. That's my stereo rig for looking at my stereo content, my stereo home videos for my kids and stuff. And that uses linear polarizers, and this is an old, ancient, portable daylight silver screen that I had sitting in a box. Using these two systems, we operated 9 eyes of 9 patients. These are pretty typical demographics for the vitreoretinal surgical population. We performed 9 surgeries, and you know, all these surgeries are divided into parts. 9 vitrectomies, 8 epiretinal membrane peels, 7 internal limiting membrane peels, 3 cataract surgeries, 1 air fluid exchange, and 1 retrieval of a lens implant that was accidentally dropped into the posterior segment by another surgeon. The results, adequate visualization in all patients, excellent surgical ergonomic comfort in all cases, acceptable operative times, and no complications. You know, here is a soon-to-be-published patient data sheet. Here's preoperative versus postoperative visual acuity. Stuff that's down and to the right is a good outcome. Stuff, the points that are up and to the left are a not-so-good outcome. Do no harm or improve the vision. That's what they tell us in medical school. P less than 0.01, the vision here, the visual results were excellent. I'll take the machine vision video, please, Dan. If you all have your 3D glasses, this is going to be in 3D. Maybe we wait for folks to get their glasses. Okay, Dan, go ahead. So this is my first try at 3D titling. And maybe we could turn down the volume a little bit. So here's the entry of the third trocar into the eye. And you see the glare off the lens, and I turn the microscope light off. You see the vitreous humor, which is the gelatinous stuff that's being eaten by this little Pac-Man on a stick called a vitreous cutter. And we have to clear out the vitreous to give me safe access to the back wall of the eye. I'm injecting a dye called Indocyanine Green. It helps to mark the tissues that we're removing. This is a wide-angle view, so I'm removing the peripheral vitreous and the extra dye. And that's the view as I'm getting ready to do the membrane peel. We change optical systems again. Again, this forceps is 500 microns in diameter. We get an edge of membrane. You see I'm being very timid here, because this is the first time I did this with machine vision. The view is different. There's a little bit of a learning curve. And you see the membrane being pulled up. And there it is. That's the typical appearance of an epiretinal membrane. These patients have symptoms of decreased visual acuity as well as distortion, because the membrane actually wrinkles the retina. You can actually see in this video, you can actually see the corrugation of the back of the retina, how it's been wrinkled up, and that maps the world in a topographically different fashion and creates all sorts of distortion. Straight lines look crooked. So here's some more epiretinal membrane. Now, after we're done peeling the epiretinal membrane, there's a layer under the epiretinal membrane called the retinal internal limiting membrane. This is clear, and you see I'm picking it up here and peeling it. It's the foot plates of the Mueller cells, not that that matters. That acts as a scaffold for scar tissue reformation, so we remove that at the time of surgery as well, which prevents us from having to come back another day. And you can see here that this membrane is smooth and clearly histologically different. So this here is called scleral depression. At the end of the surgery, we indent the outside of the eye to look for tears in the retina, which are the main complication of this. Lenny, this is what we were talking about the other day, if you're in here. Then we remove the trocars. And there's no sutures placed in this operation. This patient had a little bit of a bleeder that we cauterized. And 3 weeks later, he was seen 20/20 without distortion. We'll go back to the PowerPoints, please. So, thank you. So the answer here to the question is, yes, we can, all right? We can do surgery with 3D HD machine vision. We can do the finest microsurgery there is from the standpoint of some of the finest microsurgery there is from the standpoint of the operating surgeon. And we can do this in an environment which is really some of the toughest visualization from the standpoint of the engineers designing the 3D HD machine vision components. We can do this with excellent anatomic and visual outcomes, acceptable surgical times, about 30% slower than with normal vision for this particular operation, this early in the learning curve, and with superior surgeon discomfort. So then the next question comes up, why? Why would you do this, Riemann? Why is this relevant? Is it because you're a frustrated engineer that went to medical school? Turns out that we've just shown that kind of from a pixelar resolution perspective, we can approximate 20/20 pixelar density and pixelar visual acuity with machine vision in the operating room. It raises the question, and this is the reason I'm giving this talk to you today, about whether machine vision could ever be better than human vision. I submit to you, yes, and I'll just briefly touch on three reasons why. So we all know the human luminosity function, the sensitivity of the human retina to electromagnetic radiation, Roy G. Biv. And we all know that if we expand that spectrum a little bit to include some UV and near IR, the human luminosity function doesn't look that impressive when you compare it to what the sun puts out and what silicon chips see. Our silicon cameras see all sorts of photons that our eyes do not see. And I want to show you these two images that I took on Saturday when I was seeing patients. This is a visible light photograph of the back of the eye. This is the exact same eyeball. This is a patient with age-related macular degeneration. This is an infrared photograph of the back of the eyeball. And you can unequivocally, undoubtedly see, you know, this is pretty much what I see when I look in clinically. This is the infrared image. There is information on the infrared image, which is not on the visible light image, and there's information on the visible light image, which is not on the infrared image. That is really important. Right. Now, the second reason, what about digital imaging, image processing? Imagine taking those extra photons that you've just imaged. Last night we were talking about the possibility of a four subpixel pixel, red, green, blue, and IR, right? Four channels, why not? And imagine then processing that in a way that intelligently and sensibly presents surgeons or optometrists, for example, in the clinic with information that helps them make decisions. Imagine taking that information and then using it to track real time, track instrument positions. Preoperative diagnostic studies, of which there are many just in the field of retina, and digitally overlaying those onto the surgical field, real, live. Turns out the folks at TrueVision are already doing this. Here's a brain, and here's an MRI of a brain, and the TrueVision folks are digitally overlaying these. What about a cut-by-numbers, a digital overlay? The folks at TrueVision are already doing this. Capsulorhexis is the first significant step of cataract surgery, and here you see an overlay that tells the surgeon where to cut. Here, cut on the dotted lines to cure astigmatism or to place a toric intraocular lens. These tools are already being developed. Remote surgery, I'll skip this in the interests of time. Let's go to the stills, and I'll wrap it up. So, I presented a huge amount of information today, let's put on your glasses again. And what I presented is really only the tip of the iceberg. Right? I have a job. I take care of hundreds of patients every week. I don't need another job, but I am absolutely certain, I can't develop this myself. I'm a surgeon, I'm in the clinic all day, every day. But you all can develop this technology. And what I've shown you today is just the tip of the iceberg. Okay, this is an iceberg floating in Icy Strait, Alaska. We all know that the tip of the iceberg is only 90% of the volume of the iceberg. And we know, next slide please, that iceberg, this is on the flight from Juneau, Alaska to Anchorage, Alaska, and you see these glaciers coming down off the mountains and breaking off as thousands of icebergs in this lake. There are thousands of icebergs. Next slide. They have unbelievable power when they're part of the glacier gouging out the granite rock face, next slide, and carving out magnificent landscapes like you see in Alaska. This is real close to Taku Glacier. You see how all of those icebergs carved out this canyon here of magnificent glacial landscape. I will leave it up to you to do this. I'm happy to help in any way that I can, but I'm convinced that the next, we'll go back to the PowerPoint, please. I'm absolutely convinced that the next, that the next, that the future of surgical visualization is going to be absolutely huge. We'll go back to the PowerPoint. In the next 5 to 10 years, and I leave it up to you all to do that. Thank you very, very much. PowerPoint's not coming up. It's just a thank you slide. That's all it is. So
thank you very much, Doctor.
Thank you.
Any quick questions? All right. Thank you very much. That was a great speech.